Lots to talk about. We don't get to do this segment often because lots, you know,
not here all the time.
He's been ditching us left and right.
Feel free to do it without me.
It doesn't have the same.
We can get him on FaceTime from Cabo.
Yeah, right. We'll try that next time.
Why not?
I sense some sarcasm from that laugh. Let's go back to Sergei Bobrovsky because it's been a really intriguing story all season long. It got maybe reached the peak of that intrigue when he was suspended basically by the team for what happened after the game in Tampa. The way Korpisalo is playing, does that affect Bobrovsky's future at all? Does it enhance the chances that the team may trade him before the deadline?
I think it certainly gives the general manager more of a comfort level in knowing that, hey, we got a guy that's pretty competent back there. He hasn't been our starter, but we love the way he's playing. We love the way the team is playing in front of him. I think he's certainly building some confidence with the group. But ultimately, Jackie, you got to look at it this way, and we'll try to make it really simple. If you have a below-average offer, just keep them. Don't bother moving them.
Agree.
If you have a decent offer, you're going to contemplate it. You're going to look at all the factors and make a tough call. If you have a great offer, in my opinion, you'd be crazy not to trade them. This is what you have to remember, Ege. Last year, Columbus played really great in the first round, and they lost.
Yep.
This year, they'll probably play Washington or Pittsburgh in the first round. Possibly.
Yep.
They could win and play one of the lower teams.
Yep.
But still, do you want to be out in the first round and lose a guy like Bob?
Yeah.
Or Panarin, for that matter?
Yeah.
No, you absolutely do not. Not when you're the Columbus Blue Jackets and the lifeline of your organization is getting younger players and prospects in there and letting them grow and develop. You can't afford to lose a veteran like him for nothing unless the offers are terrible.
Yeah, you're not going to sell your house just to give it away, right?
Right.
If you have to sell your house, you're looking for a good offer. Hopefully you get one, you make a deal. It's the same with players. I would say this, a couple of things to consider. First of all, they're in a very unique circumstance as a franchise because they've never won a playoff series, right? And they feel like they probably have their best roster of players right now. So they'd like to maybe be able to make amends with Bobrovsky, hope to get him playing better than he's playing right now. See, those numbers haven't been very good, and make a push, and then maybe still engage with him. But from what I hear, it's pretty much a done deal that he's going to be leaving there. So they got to see, as you say, what the offers are. And I think one thing I want to go back to as well is that we talked about that situation that occurred in Tampa, and it's kind of been out there now. What happened is that he basically, when he was pulled from that game, he just decided to go in and get his equipment off, take a shower, and the team thought that was, and I think this, I feel this was, you know, the right move by the team. You can't do that. If a defenseman is having a poor game and gets benched in the third period, he can't just get up and go to the locker room and change and take a shower, and especially if Korpisalo had gotten injured late in the game, now Bobrovsky has to go back in. Where is he? In the shower. I mean, that doesn't help anybody.
What a story that would be.
That would have been, I mean, that really.
There was only 10 minutes, but it was a possibility.
It's a possibility.
Heaven forbid.
There's no doubt, especially a goalie coming off the bench cold like that against a really good offense like the Tampa Bay Lightning. It's a possibility for sure. So I think Bobrovsky is very fortunate that that scenario did not unfold. I think the team was wise to do what they did. I think they wanted to send a message and say, hey, this is just not acceptable. They've kind of moved on from it now. But it'll be up to Bobrovsky to play well when he's been given an opportunity and to get that stock up. And just, you want to be playing better because it's a good thing for him. If he's playing better and they don't trade him and he has a good playoff run, guess what? His value goes up, right? So that's the best way to go.
Just to close the circle.
Yeah.
It appears he's been pretty clear that even though he has a no trade, that he would accept a trade as well. So, and he's not going to go just
anywhere
for the sake of going anywhere. And that certainly is a right that he earned. But I would think if Jarmo Kekäläinen can create a market, he'll know where to create that market as to teams that he would go, and something could happen.
Tough spot.
Yeah.
Well,
tough spot. Rick Nash was a boatload last year, I thought, for the Rangers.
Yeah.
You get a first-round pick, you get a legitimate prospect, you get another player off the roster. So it's going to take a lot, I think, to pick up a guy like Sergei Bobrovsky.
Well, we love talking contracts when we have you on the show lots
because
you know a lot about them. And with this news, we thought this is the perfect time to talk about it. Dale Weiss clearing waivers, likely headed to Lehigh Valley. And this kind of got us thinking about free agent signings of years past.
Only a couple of years past.
That have been very rich. Weiss signed his current deal in 2016. So we took a look at some of the top deals from July 1st of 2016.
You see, how do you like
Lucic
that one?
Here.
Oiler fans? Keep going. We'll go through them.
Okay, Kyle.
How do you like
Poso,
that one, Buffalo Sabre fans?
Yeah.
We're going to see a theme here.
And Kyle's, unfortunately for Kyle, he was very ill at one point and had some significant health issues, but not good. Andrew Ladd, that's another one. That's a lot of money and a lot of term for a player who was a little bit longer in the tooth when they signed the deal.
Louis Erickson at 6
years. Yep, sounded like a good idea to play with the Sedins at the time.
Yeah, now they're retired.
Ron Suvas.
It didn't work out quite that way.
Right, right. Detroit needed some help down the middle. Okay, he's done that.
And you know what's funny about Franz Nielsen? The Islanders came back to him and made him an offer, but he made a kind of a handshake agreement with the Red Wings, and to his credit, he wouldn't go back on it, so he ends up in Detroit.
David Backes, very clear. I'm not that old.
And he's scratched tonight. David
Backes. He's a healthy scratch,
But we don't know that for certain. We believe he
will be healthy. We believe he will be healthy scratch,
And Darren Helm, probably the most economical of the
And he re-signed with the team he was with, the Detroit Red Wings.
They knew what he was giving them.
Yeah.
Troy Brouwer, we know that didn't work out.
That did not work out. He ended up down in Florida now.
Yep.
So it's interesting, and I would say this, and Lotch, you tell me if you disagree. I think the day those signings happens, I didn't really think any of them were that great that day.
No, but I'll tell you what happens, Ege, is that
the league is chasing.
The league is so close now, and you've got ownership or president or somebody above the GM, or you may have some circumstance yourself in terms of where you're at in your tenure of managing a club. There is a lot of pressure, and in a perfect world, a lot of those signings wouldn't happen. I actually think they're going to drift a little bit away for a while because people are investing a lot more, as we're seeing, in the younger players.
Yeah.
Okay, and what does that mean? It means Mikko Rantanen, Patrick Laine. We can just keep on going down the list.
Brock Austin Matthews.
Besser, Austin Matthews, Mitch Marner. These are the guys that I think clubs are going to focus a little bit more of their attention and pay bigger dollars than we've seen in the past, too.
Yeah.
And I think in the past, too, the teams that were feeling that pressure to make a big signing or make a big deal, so to speak, when free agency would come around, they would overvalue whoever the big name was that particular year. Like, whoever those top three, when really you have to kind of look at it on the big picture scale. Like, okay, they're the big free agent signing this year, but where do they fall sort of in the actual National Hockey League amongst the players?
And, you know,
playing?
And most of the guys, too, when you get to free agency now, years gone by, maybe 2005, 2006, 2007. On July 1st, there was some significant names that would become available. I go all the way back to 05 out of the work stoppage. Scott Niedermeyer was a was a free agent signing, and there was a number of them going back even before that. But now most of these guys sign long-term deals. I mean, like, if you're a good player in a market, John Tavares is the odd guy who doesn't sign a long-term deal and stay in the situation he's in. I mean, like Steven Stamkos, right? He went up to the looked right into the water and said, "Nah, I don't think so. I'm going to stay in Tampa." So most of these guys do end up signing long-term deals and stay. And so the market is not that great to begin with.
By the way, from our research department, the last big name, big money free agent signing to go on and win the Stanley Cup the following year was Marian Hossa.
Wow. That's a while ago.
It was 2009.
Yes, that's a while ago.
My memory did
say playing in the finals every year, no matter what team he was on.
That's right. He was on the loser a couple years.
Well, that was the year. It was like he was chasing, always coming so close.
Yeah. Lost with Detroit, lost with Pittsburgh, lost with Detroit, won with Chicago.
Yes.
There you go. Figured it out.
Yeah. Great player, too. Great player.
Yes, certainly.
That's one guy that, talk about no maintenance.
Yeah.
Marian Hossa was that guy. Just do what he does. Consistency.